Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the lecture of Real Analysis 1. Okay, let us have a look at the concepts which we have studied in the last lecture. We have solved one example in the last lecture, which is actually showing linear function is integrable. Showing linear function is integrable. What is the linear function we have taken? 5x plus 2 is the linear function, and which we have proved to be integrable, right? After this, one more example we have taken, defining the function to be 0 and 1, okay, for the different values of x to be rational and y. X to be irrational, and with the latter we have tried to understand the meaning of the definition of integration a to b, but the value
मैडम तुमचे आवाज कट होता है मैम
of b is less than or equals to a. Therefore, here we will say that area is not negative. Area is going to be non-negative only, but according to the sign.
मैडम तुम लाइक पॉज व्हायला लागले व्हिडिओ
मैम यू आर नॉट ऑडिबल
हियर मेजरली हेलो नाउ चेक नॉट ऑडिबल
मध्ये मध्ये ब्रेक व्हायला लागली मॅडम तुमची वॉइस
इट्स मे बी ड्यू टू एन इंटरनेट इशू इट इज नॉट शोइंग टू मी दैट देयर इज अ प्रॉब्लम इट्स कनेक्टेड टू इंटरनेट Okay, bear with me. This may be due to some internet issue. Okay. Then later we have seen the effect of the change on this inequality while b is less than or equals to a, right? What is the inequality we have proved in the previous lecture? That the value of integration lies between small m times b minus a to capital M times b minus a, provided b is greater or equal by a. And with some proper steps, we have shown that whenever b is less than or equals to a, the bound are going to change. That is, m small m times b minus a will become the upper bound. That of capital M times b minus a will become the lower bound. Okay. Then we have moved towards an important deduction. The first deduction we have seen is if f is bounded and integrable on closed interval a b, then there exists a number lambda lying between the bounds of a such that integration value is lambda times b minus a. This I have explained already to you with the help of the figure also. Second deduction says that if we add the condition of continuity on the function and just continuing the previous deduction, the value of lambda can be replaced by a function value. We have seen with the help of step function also. We have seen with the help of a step function which is not continuous actually, that such a lambda do not exist for the continuous function. Okay. Now let us come to for today's lecture. In this lecture we are going to continue the deductions. Therefore, let us continue to deduction number 3. Deduction number 3, we will write the statement. Statement saying that if f is bounded and integrable, f is bounded and integrable on a given interval a and b, and k is a number, actually which is a bound, k is a number such that, what such that? Mod of f of x is less than or equals to k for all x in closed interval a b, then what integration is to k times modulus of b minus a. This is what the deduction we want to prove. Okay, what is this k? May I say k is the bound के टू प्लस के. कैन वी से दैट माइनस के इज द इन्फिमा एंड प्लस के विल बी द सुप्रीमा? कैन वी से लाइक दिस?
यस मैम.
हेलो, am I audible to students? Good. Okay, whenever we are writing this statement, mod of f of x is less than or equals to k, then the value of function actually lies between minus k to plus k, na? Therefore, whether we can say that minus k is infima and plus k is the suprema for the given function, is it true?
Yes, ma'am.
No, it is actually. Because...
But it's right. Between minus k to plus k, na, then.
But still, we cannot call minus k as infima and plus k as suprema. Okay? See, here I will show you with a different color. See, mod of f of x is less than or equals to k. It means that f of x lies between minus k to plus k. Okay? Looking to this right hand side inequality, I can say k is an up. Upper bound, that of minus k is the lower bound, correct na? But what is infima? Infima is greatest lower bound, suprema is least upper bound. Then what is the question? What is the relation between arbitrary lower bound and greatest lower bound? Similarly, one may have a question, what is the relation between least upper bound and arbitrary upper bound? The names actually itself tells you the meaning, na? Correct. Minus k is arbitrary lower bound. If I say small m and capital M are the infima and suprema value, then this m is the greatest lower bound, right? No? Then what is the relation between lower bound and greatest lower bound? Surely less equal?
Yes, ma'am.
Correct?
Yes, ma'am.
What about this step? Relation between least upper bound and arbitrary upper bound? Still it is?
It is also less than equal.
Good. Then least upper bound is actually a suprema. And if I write this suprema to be capital M and plus K to be an arbitrary upper bound, then what is the relation between the suprema and arbitrary upper bound? It is less equal, na? Capital M is less equal by K. Therefore, which kind of relation we have obtained? Minus K less than or equals to M. Infima less than or equals to suprema less than or equals to
plus K.
Capital K. With this statement, good. Whenever we are writing this statement, it doesn't mean that minus K is infima and plus K is suprema. No doubt this minus k is lower bound, plus k is upper bound. But we cannot say these are the infinity modulus b minus a. Okay, now we will discuss in detail the possibilities. The first possibility we will discuss, b is greater than a. Correct? Here I will write for or if for b greater than a. B greater than a means b minus a is strictly greater than 0. B minus a is strictly greater than 0. Then we have already followed one inequality, na? Small m times b minus a. Here I will write. We know that. What we know that? Or here one may follow another steps. Writing this and integrate. Okay, we know that mod of f of x is less than or equals to k, which actually means that minus k less than or equals to f of x less than or equals to plus k for all x in the closed interval AB, right? Now what I will do? I will integrate, integrating every term in this inequality. Integrating every term from a to b. What we will get if I integrate? These are the constants. These are the two constants. And in the last lecture itself, we have seen that the integration of a constant term is constant into b minus a. Correct, na? For the middle term, I'll keep as it is. Integration a to b f of x dx, which is less than or equals to k into b minus a. Is that fine? Okay. Now look at the terms. This integration value lies between fixed value negative to positive. Therefore, may I say the modulus value of integration is less than or equals to, yes, less than or equals to
k times b minus a.
B minus a. Good. K into b minus a. Let me call it as statement number one. Okay. And this is what we have derived for b greater than a. Second step, we will write for, yes, b less than a or a greater than b. One and the same thing. Correct? Now, for a greater than b, what we will do? We will just interchange the positions of a and b. Correct? Therefore, interchanging a and b in statement number 1, we obtain interchanging a and b in statement number 1. What we have obtained? Integration b to a f of x dx is less than or equals to k into a minus b. Correct now? But what is the value here? B minus a. As the case we have taken, b is greater than a. Therefore, this quantity on the right is greater than 0. Similarly, here in the second part, we are considering a is greater than b. Therefore, here for a greater than b, again this a minus b is greater than 0. Therefore, whatever is the right quantity, the right part of the inequality is positive, is going to be positive. Therefore, what I will do here, if I interchange the limits of the integration, what will be the effect on the integration? It will be introduced with a negative sign. But as we are in the modulus, let us absorb the negative to write this as integration f of x dx. Right? And is less than or equals to k into a minus b. Right? Now let me call this as equation number 2. Now from 1 and 2, what we have observed? Whatever is the relation between a and b, this right side quantity is positive. A minus b is positive, b minus a is positive. Therefore, from 1 and 2, one can put the bracket in the modulus itself. Therefore, may I write this is less than or equals to k into a minus b or k into b minus a, one and the same thing. Correct, na? Once we put it in the modulus, is there any effect that a is greater than b or b is greater than a? No.
No.
It will finally is going to give us a non-negative quantity. Okay. And the third case to discuss is for a is equal to b. Okay. Let us check what is the effect on this inequality if a is equal to b. What is the value of the left hand side of the inequality? Zero?
Zero.
What is the effect on the right hand side of the inequality? Zero?
It will go to zero.
Therefore, may I say the result is trivial. That is obviously true, one can say. Result is trivial for a is equal to b. If what we have proved as a reduction number 3, that if k is the bound for the function here, then modulus value of integration is less than or equals to k into mod of b minus a. Okay, this is the third deduction. Let us move forward for deduction number 4. Deduction number 4. Deduction number 4 is very easy. It says that if the function is non-negative, its integration is also non-negative. Let me write the statement. If f is bounded and integrable, bounded and integrable on closed interval AB, and f of x is non-negative. Non-negative means positive included with 0, greater equal by 0 for all x in the closed interval a to b. Then what we want to prove? Integration a to b f dx is greater equal by 0 if b is greater equal by a and is less equal by 0 if b is less than or equals to a. Okay. Actually nothing to prove in this statement. Everything is quite but obvious. How? Let us check. If the function is non-negative, then what kind of or where is the possibility of having the curve? In which quadrant the curve lies?
Quadrant.
First. May I say that it will lie in first and second quadrant? The curve, if f of x is a non-negative, the curve will lie above x-axis. Above x-axis means it is in first and second quadrant. If the value is strictly greater than 0, this may be the nature of a curve, which will not touch the x-axis. But if suppose the value is equal to 0, then somewhere it is going to touch the x-axis. Is this clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, if the nature of the curve is above x-axis, then what is the area bounded by the curve? Surely non-negative, no? Surely non-negative. Correct, na? If this was a situation, right? If this is the curve under the consideration, and if I want to find out the area bounded by the curve in this x, in this interval a to b, say, then what is the area bounded by the curve with x-axis? This will be the area, na? But according to the sign convention, this area is positive, this area is negative. Correct, na? Area above x-axis is taken positive, area below x-axis is taken to be negative as per the sign convention. As per the sign convention. Therefore, what is the resultant area? Resultant area is going to be 0. But in this situation, as the whole curve is going to lie above x-axis, what will be the area bounded by the curve? May I say it is non-negative?
Yes.
It is non-negative. I cannot say positive because if the curve under the consideration is going to lie on x-axis, means it's a straight line which is lying on x-axis itself. Okay, then what will be the curve, area bounded by the curve? Suppose this is the line under the consideration, lying on x-axis. What is the area bounded by this curve with x-axis?
Zero,
no? Therefore, zero along with positive value. For combining both, one can say that the area bounded by the curve is greater equal by 0, that is non-negative. Correct, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Good. Therefore, the curve, the area is non-negative is if b is greater equal by a. What will happen if b is less than or equals to a? If this is a situation, the area is non-negative. What will happen if b is less than or equals to a? Then we have to go to the left direction, na? We have to start with B and according to the sign convention, this area should be negative of the previous one. Correct, na? Negative of this previous case. Now the previous case is having the value of integration is non-negative. What is its negative value? Non-positive. Correct, na? The value is non-positive. Okay, here I will write the explanation. What is the explanation? Since f of x is greater equal by 0, since f of x is greater equal by 0 for all x in your closed interval a to b, okay, f is bounded, no doubt. If f is bounded, what I will say? Small m will be the infima, capital M will be m times b minus a2, small m times b minus a2, capital M times b minus a. Now what is this value? negative. Therefore, this is actually giving us non-negative, greater equal to zero. This value is also non-negative. Therefore, a value
Ma'am, you are not audible.
Let me consider two non-negative values x and y. If I consider any value z in between x and y, may I say z is non-negative? Greater equal to 0. Correct, na? Therefore, this statement is quite but obvious from our inequality. From which inequality? From this inequality. Okay. Then similarly, for the second one, if b is less than or equals to a, the area of integration is introduced with a negative. Therefore, non-negative becomes non-positive. Is that fine? We will go for next deduction, deduction number 5. Okay. Now, this next deduction is just obtained by the previous one. Okay, and the deduction statement says that if f and g are bounded and integrable on closed interval AB such that, what such that? F is greater or equal by g, then what then is? Then integration a to b f dx is greater or equal by integration a to b g dx if b is greater or equal to a, and integration a to b f dx is less than or equals to integration a to b g dx whenever b is less than or equals to a. Okay, what the statement says that if one function is greater or equal by another function, then the corresponding integrations also follow the same inequality. The corresponding integration also follows the same inequality. Okay. Now the proof of this statement is very easy. Okay. How the proof is going to be given? By the previous statement. As f is greater equal by g given, what about f minus g? Greater equal by 0. Correct. And by deduction 4, what we have proved in deduction 4? In deduction 4, we have proved that if f is greater or equal by 0, then integration f is also greater or equal by 0. Let me use the same confusion. Here we are writing f minus g is greater or equal by 0. Therefore, may I write integration a to b f minus g dx is greater or equal by 0 for b greater or equal by a, and less than or equal to 0 for b less than equals to a. Let me separate the integration. Integration f minus g can this is less equal if, yes, if b is less equal by functions, which are important for us for the sake of proving the next result. Now, refinement of partition. Refinement of partition. What do you want?
Ma'am, complete 6 minutes. Tumcha video pause zalela ahe.
अजून मला दिसतोय इथे ऍक्च्युली. आता येतोय?
यस मॅम
येतोय आता.
ओके, म्हणजे हा
डिडक्शन स्टील द व्हिडिओ इज गेटिंग फॉल्स.
आय थिंक देर इज अ नेटवर्क इश्यू टुडे. If it is still not getting clear. Okay, let me stop for today. We will take this in the next lecture.